press into your presence, oh God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Well, welcome, welcome, welcome all you saints of God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. How about y'all, right? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God is good. Hallelujah. I know we're going to do a welcome, but I did want to just acknowledge these beautiful, precious friends of ours, the Everetts. They are in the house today. Hallelujah. All right. Well, let's go before the Lord in prayer. We won't delay what he's ready to do. Father, we come before you right now in the name of Jesus. We thank you so much for this day that you have made, Lord God. And we all will rejoice in it and be glad. We thank you for your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path, Lord God. We yearn and thirst after righteousness. And we yearn and thirst after your word, Lord God. Speak a word today, God, that will forever change us from the inside out. Lord, we thank you and we praise you. We don't take it for granted. We come with great expectation, Lord God, to hear from you, Lord God. We thank you that your man of God has placed himself before the altar and he is ready to pour out right now. And so we thank you, Lord. Now, as we enter into praise and worship, let it be a sweet savor to you, Lord God. We thank you that as we worship you, we'll worship you in spirit and in truth. In the name of Jesus, Father, we give all of ourselves to you, our spirit, soul, and body, as we yield ourselves to you, to the Spirit of the God, Spirit of the living God, to fall fresh on us, to use us in a mighty way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Amen. Glory to God. All right, so let's all read Acts 1, 8, American Standard Version. Let us all read.
But ye shall receive power when the Holy Spirit is come upon you, and ye shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth.
Glory to God. Amen. You know what? It's enough of us in here to start a fire.
That's right.
It's enough of us to start a fire and allow the Spirit of God to burn in this place. Burn off anything that is not like him in this place. Hallelujah. So we're going to sing Spirit Breakout, and I want you to press in and believe that the heaven, on earth as it is in heaven, give us this day our daily bread. On earth as it is in heaven, on earth, whatever is in heaven, it can be on earth today. Hallelujah. So we're calling for that to come forth in Jesus' name. Y'all ready?
Yes.
Amen. All right, let's Spirit Breakout. Hallelujah. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on us today. Hallelujah. On earth as it is in heaven, give us this day our daily bread. In the name of Jesus, hallelujah. We bless your name today, God. Holy Spirit, you're welcome.
revive us.
Restore us.
Refresh us.
Say it again.
Revive us. Restore us. Refresh us.
One more time for the King.
Revive us. Restore us. Refresh us.
Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Glory to your name.
Thank you, God.
Oh, my Lord. Let's read from Romans chapter 8, verse 37 out of the King James Version. Everybody together, let's read.
Nay, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us.
That is good news, everybody. Hallelujah. Shout hallelujah. We have the victory through Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Come on, I'm glad to see everybody already on their feet. We're going to bring some energy. We're going to give it to God. Sing along, everybody. Come on. I've got evidence. Say it. I've got confidence. I'm a conqueror. I know that I win.
I know who I am.
God wrote it in his plan.
Come on.
For me.
y'all believed Gerard when he said he got victory? How many of y'all believed him? How many of y'all believe when he said, I got victory? How many of y'all know you have victory?
Yes, Lord.
How many of you know that you have the victory and you got to stop worrying?
That's
you
right.
Stop being concerned. Don't worry about your health, your finances, because you got victory.
Praise
Everybody
God.
Say, I got victory.
I got victory.
I got a victory.
I got a victory.
Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God. I believed you when you said that, brother. I believed you.
Woo!
Hallelujah. I know who I am.
Woo.
Hey, praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, baby girl. Come on. You want to come up?
See, this is good. This is good.
Praise God. Come on, look out, everybody.
Yeah.
Yes.
Praise God.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise
Amen.
God. Well, welcome to Heirs Christian Center Church, where we are equipping heirs.
That's right.
For Amen. The kingdom of God. Amen.
Amen.
Because we know who we are.
Yes.
We got
yes.
a victory.
Thank
we
you,
got
Lord.
A victory.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Praise
Hallelujah.
God. All right. We want to welcome all our visitors, our special guests that came in. Hallelujah.
Yes.
All right. Any other visitors in the house? We want to acknowledge you. We welcome you. Thank you for visiting us this morning. We know that you came to a place where you are truly a friend and a family member. Amen.
Amen.
We welcome you. Welcome, welcome. Welcome. Hallelujah. Praise God. Say welcome. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. And you know what? This is a victory. Y'all don't know. Every time I see my baby girl face, my grandbaby. This is a victory. God has truly given us victories, y'all.
Man.
We have to stop and take a moment to reflect on the good things.
Amen.
On the good things.
Amen.
Don't let the news control you.
Amen.
Don't let situations control you. Don't let the job control you.
Yes.
Don't let the doctor's reports control you.
Yes.
Because you have the victory. Amen.
Yes.
You have the victory.
Yes. Yes.
Glory
yes.
to God. Hallelujah.
Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
All right,
let's go to the Lord in prayer so we can continue to worship our Father,
thank you, Father.
That
you,
has
Lord.
Given us the victory. Amen.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, we thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
We thank you for allowing us in your presence, Heavenly Father. We thank you for the covering. We thank you for all the blessings that you have given us, Heavenly Father. We've come to worship you, Heavenly Father.
Yes.
We come to glorify your name this morning, Heavenly Father. We come to lift you up, Heavenly Father. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
We thank you so much, Father, for everything that you have given us. We ask that you continue to cover us, Heavenly Father, and we continue to submit to you, Heavenly Father. We thank you so much.
Thank
you. So much, Heavenly Father. We just thank you for all those gifts. We ask that you give a special anointing on our worship team as they continue to praise. And we ask a special anointing
Thank
on
you.
Our pastor as he come bring forth the word, Heavenly Father.
Yes, God.
May you give him a word that is powerful and needed. In mm-hmm. Jesus' name we pray.
Jesus, mighty.
Amen.
Jesus name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Glory to God.
Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Jesus. Our next scripture, it comes from Psalm 23, verses 1 through 3, the King James Version. Ready, everybody stand. Let's read.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. For his sake. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. Thank you, God.
The Lord is my shepherd.
He goes before me.
He goes before me.
Defender behind me.
Defender behind me.
I won't fear.
My cup's overflowing.
From Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11, out of the King James Version. Everybody together, let's read. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We have to endure. He's saving the best for life.
Plans to pray. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, dearly Father, we lift you up. We just thank and praise you for your peace, presence, and power, and just being in this place and just reminding us that you got some best set up for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you, guys. All right, you may be seated. Children can meet the Airborne Children's Ministry workers in the back. Lord, we ask that you create an atmosphere for them, touch their lives, touch those that are ministering to them. We believe, Lord, that they'll experience your best for last in Airborne Children's Ministry. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, how's everybody today? All right, I know we got some people transitioning to children's ministry and transitioning, but I'm going to take a second just to kind of remind us of Wednesday. Our teaching on Wednesday is blind spots and blackouts. So we talked about this in the foundational class next door and in Bible school yesterday at 7 o'clock. Like, you know, quite a few of us are, just trying to get to a place where we understand some things and we see some things and we realize what God is doing. And, you know, we can get past those moments in our life. Like, how many people have been in situations where you've made some mistakes and you're like, I can't believe I did that, you know? Oh, we only got four people that's happened to. All right, so let's try that again. How many people have made some mistakes and we say, we can't believe I did that, right? All right, so some questions I ask because I really don't know, but that one I actually knew the answer to. All right, so, but you mean well, right? Like, I don't think we wake up in the morning and we're just going to do something stupid or do something disobedient. We're not, right? No. Jump in here anytime. Just making sure. Do I change the message? You know, because we, all right. So the reality is, you know, people aren't intending to do that. Or how about this? Sometimes there's a struggle with doing what you hear God wants you to do. You know, like you hear it, you know God wants you to do it. You might hear a man of God, woman of God, your cousin, your mom, some people that you've mentioned. But it's like a struggle with crossing over to that, the reality. Like, you know, when you realize something, you do change, right?
Right. Yes. Amen. Yes.
Yes.
You sure?
Yes. All right. Work, y'all telling on yourselves, right? All right. So, but sometimes there's a blind spot. I don't know. I don't realize there's something I need to change, right? Or there's a blackout. I'm totally oblivious to, as we talked about on Wednesday, the cause of the curse. You know, I'm like, I can't believe, I wonder why that's happening. You know, you're looking around and it really is you. All right, so we've been talking about blind spots and blackouts, and the reason why I wanted to bring that to our attention even this morning to kind of challenge us to make sure, even if you can't be here on Wednesday, some people can't, like, please spend time with the video because God is trying to get us to see. Yeah. Like, yes, the vision is living in manifestation, but it's hard to live in a manifestation to God. Like, do you know some people are going to be walking in the manifestation and some people are going to be standing there going, I just don't understand. How are they walking in manifestation? I'm right here too because of the blind spots or the blackouts, okay? And so this is the other thing. How many of you really want to help somebody in your life? Like, you really, okay, good. We got good hands. You know, I know Josh, you got your baby, but I know you're trying to help people all the time. You know, you got a ministry that helps people, right? All right. And so we talked about this in class, but if you're blind and you're going to help someone who's blinder, no, I'm saying, you're going to help someone who is blinder than you. When I said who's blinder, she said you. That's not what I meant, all right? All right, what I'm saying is, so then that's the blind leading. But the person that's blind leading the blind is going to help. So they don't believe they're blind, right? And so sometimes this happens because we're a truth church, a word church, but it's a truth church, right? So it's not, like, we want everybody to like us. We want everybody to keep rushing back to all the services just like any other ministry, but not at the expense of somebody's life. So we don't need a crowd of blind people. Right? Does that make sense? All right, so the tough part about that is when truth comes forth, we have defaults. You right? Like, okay, I know this is probably going to be a tough question, but I'm going to ask it anyway. How many people find themselves running a lot from the things of God? So good. We got a few hands here, a few people being honest. All right. Now, how about this? How many people find themselves running, but they don't want to run? Right? Well, that happens because it's a default, right? Like sometimes when that truth is hitting you, So y'all see this in your kids, some of your teenagers, stuff like that. You ever like are having a conversation, you know, as I said teenagers, I'm trying to be nice, you know, it might not even be teenagers here. But you ever have a conversation and they start either fidgeting, moving, or all of a sudden something's on the phone, or you ever just see like, and you'd be like, I'm talking to you, right? Hey, whoa, what you doing? Pay attention. You ever find yourself saying that? Well, that's what God is saying to us. Because we do it in different ways. See, we can go get busy with stuff. You ever find yourself working extra time around the time when God's dealing with you with the truth? Do you ever find out all of a sudden that's your most benevolent times where, you know, I think I want to go see a family member. Boy, you could have seen them the whole time. Why is it the time when God's dealing with a particular truth? You know, because what happens is our default has us, that's our running. You know what I'm saying? All of a sudden, you busy. Oh, man, just, you know, I know God wants to get me to do this, but man, I'm so busy. Are you so busy? Right? You understand what I'm saying? Because the same busyness comes up when there's pleasurable things to do. But for some reason, we ain't too busy for that. That's not me putting you down. I'm saying that's a blind spot. You don't realize what your own defaults are. Right? I'm sorry. That's not the right way to say it. We don't realize what our own defaults are. Right? And so that's why, check out Wednesday's message. Slip that in, you know. All right? Please. Even if you can't be here, please check it out. All right? We need to, because around here we say we need to fight to see, right? Ed? Where is Ed at? Where did Ed go? Huh? We got cameras, don't we? Okay. All right. Ed is on assignment. Okay. All right. But Ed was saying in class. we were talking about understanding the word and how you have to watch the things that you listen to. And in particular, even watch the stuff that you post. So you may hear a nice little clip that sound good, but you don't know the core of what that ministry is about, what that person is about, and you posting it. It's one thing that you personally say, hey, you know, that little nugget is interesting. But now you posting stuff, people follow you and they following the person that you posted and the person doing all types of crazy stuff. You just like the one little quote, right? And so Ed was like, he said, man, it could be difficult. He said, I'm reading this book, man. It was a good book, saying some positive stuff. And the Holy Spirit hit him and said, man, you need to research this person. So the foreword was saying that the book baseline of the God the book was referring to through the whole time he was watching it is Buddha. And it was saying that the book... how do you say it, Tanya? Loosely based on the scripture as a man thinketh. But see, you can skip over the loosely base. That's like we skip over certain things the scripture's actually saying in the word. It said loosely based. It didn't say based. Right? And so same thing in our life. So we got to fight to see. Like it's we got to be intentional what we exposed to. Some of the things we find out, well, I don't believe that. Well, the pastor said that. Listen. Pull me to the side, ask me why I said it, and we can go over every scripture possible. You get the results of my study. You're not getting everything that, you know, I mean, I don't even finish messages. I probably got 8 pages of notes on every message I ever taught that I haven't gotten to. So it's pretty exhaustive, right? So don't reflect, just ask, and you'll get the details to it, okay? All right? Now, you're sitting here, sitting under a pastor. The people that you drive by, they ain't telling you that. You know why? They ain't pastoring you. They can say whatever. They're not responsible for you, right? And they're not trying to be irresponsible. They're just communicating what they're communicating, right? Right. So do some. Just do some. Did I say don't listen to nobody?
No.
Well, okay. Just investigate. Okay. Did I say don't post? All right, just making sure. We went through this in class. I'm making sure people be walking out of here. Pastor said, don't post messages. Don't listen to nobody. I did not say that. Some good nuggets out there. I got one from the guy in Africa the other day. All right? It's okay. All right, we good? All right, good. Let's get into what we're talking about today. Lord, I decrease that you may increase. Of thee, God, I abide in Christ and yield to you, Holy Spirit. All right, so we've been talking about the best for last, right? And today I want to kind of get into, because remember we said the best, they're kind of like behind the scenes for a while. Like what God, because the best hasn't shown up yet, right? And so they almost feel, while they're waiting on the best, disregarded. You ever felt disregarded? Seem like everybody else is doing this, like when is my turn, right? And sometimes we can get weary and well-doing and kind of what? Take a bribe or a compromise. You ever did that?
Yes.
I got to come back down there?
You're the right
turn. All right. I was just checking, man. Like, all right, so there's people that we're in good company. There's a lot of people that haven't been, that's been disregarded in the Bible. I mean, and I look at it, our life, Christ died for us, but I look at his whole flow was saving the best for last. Like he delights in delivering the unexpected. He delights in delivering the unexpected to the unsuspecting. So he delights in delivering the unexpected for the unsuspecting. Remember when we were talking about, we were reading through the Bible study fellowships in the morning of Ruth's process, right? Ruth was just locked into Naomi, right? So she got delivered Boaz. She wasn't expecting Boaz. She ain't know Boaz was even a possibility. Her focus was, I'm gonna roll with you. Ain't Boaz in your family? She ain't know Boaz was in the family. But she was unsuspecting. It ended up tremendously blessed, right? And this is what happens with our life. You know, the Father, Son, the Holy Spirit waits until there's an opportunity to show up where the needs are rampant, but the solutions are few. Right? See, this is a perfect climate for him to do his best, right? And this is the thing, his best is available where others could last. Listen, his best is available where others could last. Right? So what it means is for the best to show up, someone has to be allow themselves to be dormant, to be drowned, to be buried, to be still until the appropriate time. Right? So normally people that are experiencing the best waited on stuff that others couldn't hold out for. Right? Others couldn't last, right? I'm sustaining this greatness that's treasure hidden in my earthen vessel until the time it was designated to be seen, right? So it's very few people that can do that because people take bribes. Man, what you wait? The devil will be coming up, seeing and sending his demons and all types of. Man, what you waiting on, man? Man, do you honestly think God's like gonna show up? Look at this, such and such doing this, they doing this, they doing that, and then they're doing this. Man, why, you should just take this right here. You need to do you. Go for yours, right? People don't experience the best when they do that. So a lot of times this best shows up when we've done all we can do to stand. That's when the best shows up. Scripture says when you've done all you can do to stand, stand there for. Right? Right? This is Ephesians 6, 10 through 12. Stand there for when you've done. But the thing is, so remember the best shows up for those that can outlast some things. So when you've done all you can do to stand all that you're responsible to do, I'll get to that in a second. The best shows up, right? But a lot of times we're not doing all we can do to stand, right? Scripture says, my preaching and teaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but was in demonstration of power. So your faith should stand, not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God, right? 1 Corinthians 2, 4, and 5. Now, some of us know that scripture very well, right? My faith is not standing in the wisdom of men. All the stuff I hear in the world, things that are posted, things that are TikToked and all that. My faith is not standing in that. It's not standing in the circumstances. The power of God. So my faith is waiting on the manifestation of the power of God. Right? So, but how many people are doing all they need to do under tutors and governors to the appointed time of the Father, Galatians 4, right? How many people are doing that? Some people have been in longevity and in sometimes proximity, but they haven't been in obedience, right? So they figure after a period of time, I deserve something. But you wasn't standing, you were compromising. But you want the results of standing. It's the weirdest thing. Because you figure longevity should automatically grandfather me in. No, your obedience is what gets it. See, God ain't like the world. The Bible says God is not mocked, right? Whatsoever a man soweth, that you shall reap. That scripture is saying God doesn't have to monitor if you're going to stand for his greatness. Because you're going to reap what you sow. See, when we get the harvest, we're like, well, I don't want this. Well, yes, you do, because that's what you sow for. See, there's a cost to compromise too. Just like there's a their reward for standing, there's a cost for compromise. Your scripture says the curse causeless shall not come. But going back to blind spots and blackouts, we're in denial. We don't want to embrace the reality, right? That we're not standing. See, I think we talked about this in blind spots and blackouts, even in our secret life. The Bible says man looks on the outward appearance. So somebody may give you something based on what they see on the outside. But it says, now God, God looks on the heart. He knows if you're really standing in your heart. He knows when you're criticizing, when you're stubborn, when you're prideful, and you're asking him to promote that to greatness. He's saying, but that's not my best. That's not my best character to handle my best, greatest gifts. Right? Does that make sense? All right, so y'all still with me here, right? All right, so I think about how a lot of times we're waiting on let me just say it this way, a Red Sea best. Like, remember the Red Sea? Like, how many times was the Red Sea open? Right, but how many times was it open before that? None. But what did it take for them to experience that? You see what I'm saying? So there's something is some. Look at all that was happening before you get to the Red Sea. Look at the leader that was leading them and what he had to, the process he had to go through to believe and to stand and to trust God to be at the Red Sea when God said, oh, what you got in your hand? Stretch out your hand. For him to communicate to those he's leading, fear not, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. Right? Exodus 14, right? You see that? There's something you got. Fear not, stand still and see God's best. Oh, y'all done saw some miracles. Y'all saw some locusts show up. Y'all saw some frogs jumping around people's cribs and stuff like that. Y'all seen the water turn into blood. Y'all seen hail comes down, fire down. You even seen firstborn die. But you ain't seen God's best. Right? You about to see it right now. Because see, now you're in a seemingly insurmountable situation with limited solutions. Right? Seemingly impossible. Okay, what do we do here? Do we run down the shoreline to uncertainty down there? Right? Do we just jump in the water to uncertainty in the sea? Do we surrender to uncertainty if they just gonna like take us back captive or kill us? What do? Stand still and see. Right? You see that? All right, these qualifications or this character or this atmosphere that's created is created by those that are sacrificing being seen until they're revealed. So we sacrifice being seen until we reveal. See, most of us have never allowed ourselves to be revealed. Because we always push, you know, we all, you see me? You see, like that. We don't allow. So in other words, we may get the attention and we may be afforded a platform or we may even get a position, but did we get God's best? You can rest assured if God reveals you, this is best, right? You won't be looking over your shoulder when you experiencing God's best. But if you did it, I guarantee you'd be looking over your shoulder the whole time. So that means you're experiencing something on a platform or in a position or with a presentation that you can't even enjoy. You know how you know how when we manipulate ourselves in relationships? Just come on down here for this one. Remember how you... Well, I said that because we got a bunch of us in here that manipulate themselves in relationship. So we should get a little more cooperation here. You know, I wasn't made that up. Well, how did it play out? Honestly, the manipulative type relationship. You ever like just, you try to play it like it was a coincidence that the person ran into you? You ever did that one? But it really, oh, you still didn't embrace the reality that you forced that? You created that? All right, so maybe you'll realize that I did it. That's why I'm bringing it up. You know, like, I just happened to show up. I was happening to be, you know, I mean, I've been doing this when I was a kid. I happened to be riding my bike through your neighborhood. Happened? I don't even live on that side of town. There's no place I'm going. Where I needed to go, I didn't have to go down your street. I could have stayed on the main street till I got to the street where my dad lived, because I went from one city to the other to visit my dad. No, but I purposely went down your street. Then I think about this, I really feel like how can I put it? I'm gonna just use the word dumb on this one, okay? I feel kind of dumb on this one. I not only was riding my bike down the street, which probably makes a little bit of sense because you're riding a bike, you know, not as much energy. I walked down the street sometimes. So now I thought about this. What was the person thinking when they see me walking down their street? Oh, you just happen to be in the area on a consistent basis. I live way on the other side of town. Hoping, Pastor Mel says stalking. I wasn't going to repeat it, but I'll do it.
Well, you wanted a name, so that's
what I appreciate your help. Thank you for your assist on that one, right? And so you're hoping you run into the person. Now, the trip is, in some cases, like in my case, you end up in a relationship with a person. But when things get dicey, who's going to start to second guess the relationship? Me. All right, see, that's why you can't say certain things at this church. She says the stalker. All right, could we just let that whole stalker thing go? It's cool. It's cool. It's all right. So what I'm saying is you second guess the relationship because what's going to be in your head? I wish I did scripture like that. You know, y'all hear stalk. It's every other word come out of your mouth. Right? And so because you knew you put your hands on something, you didn't let it play itself out. Right? So I knew I put my hands on something. So since y'all use the word stalker. I'm up here on the platform, I'm eating it. Y'all gonna eat it? All the little stalking situations y'all been in or are in or are in or are in, people out there in TV land. Cause see, thank God, I was saved. We ain't have Facebook and TikTok and all that. Y'all stalking on social media. See, y'all brought up the word. People out there in TV land, they brought up the word. I did not say stalker at first. Y'all stalking on social media. So what I'm saying is you're cheating yourself from really getting God's best because you're not allowing yourself to be resurrected. You see what I'm saying? You don't resurrect it yourself. And you're going to second guess yourself when you go through stuff. So there's a benefit to being in covert. Right? So the God's best for last are for those that are in covert. See, too many people want to be seen. So you have your reward. Let's look here at Matthew 6 real quick. Matthew 6. And again, I put myself out there, but the goal is for us to make the adjustments and changes so God can get what he purposed and planned for our lives, okay? It's not really for me to make anybody look bad, so. Even though that was y'all goal by keep repeating stalker, trying to make me look bad. That's cool. I'm gonna eat it. God can resurrect me from there, okay? That's cool. As long as y'all receive the same way y'all dishing it out, I'd have no problems. All right, so Matthew 6, verse 2. It says this. It says, therefore, when thou doest thine alms, or, you know, your benevolent giving, it says, do not sound the trumpet before thee as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets. Now, this is a type of giving. You got systematic giving. You got sacrificial giving. But this is just out of benevolence and love. I just want to give, right? It says, do not sound the trumpet before thee as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the street, that they may have glory of men, be seen of men, right? Verily I say unto you, what? They have their reward, right? Verse 3, it says, and when thou doest thy alms, let not thy left hand know what thy right hand doeth. It says that thine alms may be in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret himself shall reward thee openly. So, even when I'm doing things, again, it's not saying, you know, if you give something and somebody sees you give, something wrong with you. That's not it. It's talking about motive here. Motive. There's the look at me. Look at what I did. They was talking about this athlete. I'm not necessarily promoting the athlete, just because you know what I'm talking about. And they said when he would come into a particular city, he would buy out. Back in the day, they had Toys R Us. He would buy out Toys R Us and go to the hospitals in that city and give all the toys away. Now, nobody knew about this. You know why? Because it wasn't on the news. There was no media. Now, if I said the name of the person, you'd be shocked because he had a lot of controversy. He's kind of partied all the time. He's a wild guy. But look, he did something without being seen. Right? Something major, which some of the people that are athletes to this day, I can think of one person in particular, would definitely have media there. I won't say no names there either, but you know, it'd be nice. Right? So verse 5, it says, verse 4 says, that thy alms may be in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret himself shall reward thee openly. And when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray, stand in the synagogue and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Look, verily, I say unto you, they have their reward. See, when we're doing stuff to be seen, we have our reward. Why are you even looking for God's best? You've already facilitated the payment for what you're doing. As opposed to, I'm just going to wait on God's best. Appreciate that, but I wait on God's best. Right? So you have to work to stay in covert. This is, look, you're doing these things in secret. God rewards you openly. You're doing things openly, and actually you're chastised and going through heartache and pain in secret. It's like in reverse, right? See, you have to watch manipulating stuff, because you'll end up taking bribes. And your bribe will end up replacing your birthright, and which is God's best. Right? That's what happened with what? With who? Esau, right? Right? Genesis 25:29-34. You can write it down and read it for yourself. But that was Esau. You know, just so busy. He was just too busy to pay attention, as we was talking about, walking circumspectly. Just kind of like, you know, desperate. Hey, well, I'll just take this meal at the expense of your birthright? We got to do some other negotiations. I'm not doing that. But we look at Esau and we go, man, you stupid, man. Why would you give up your birthright for some oatmeal? Right? When we tell you, your preachers told a story for years. Man, what? Esau and then people in the congregation, what? Man, Esau, stupid, man. What is he thinking? You saying to yourself, I would never do that. We're doing it all the time. We're doing it all the time. For a moment of pleasure? You giving up your birthright? That's what he did. For a moment of pleasure, for the food. We don't want to go there, right? Right? For the food, right? Something that was going to feed lust. We talked about lust in class, right? Right? Moment of pleasure, he gave up his birthright, God's best. So we're looking for the best when we've sold out for moments of pleasure. For that drink. Is it worth your birthright? See, you're looking at Esau when you're living like Esau. Oh, you're saying, I would never do that for the oatmeal, for the pottage. But what's your pottage? See, it's easy to, we talked about this, right? The mote in your eye, right? In class, right? Right? So the mote in your eye is, I would never do that for pottage. Go to the root, but you would do it for temporal pleasure. Oh, I see. See, so these hidden years that you think are boring or it's too much, right? This times of isolation are to your benefit. Let's go here, Isaiah. I guess the Lord wanted to get Isaac's attention for some reason. The Isaac hearing, the Isaac watching. Just in case you thought, oh yeah, I guess he's probably talking to the Isaacs in the house, talking to you too. All right, so Isaiah 32, verse 1. Isaiah 32, verse 1. It says, behold, a king shall reign in righteousness, and princes shall rule in judgment. A man shall be, a man shall be as a hiding place from the wind and a covert from the tempest. So he's behind the scenes. Now it opens up and says, a king shall reign in righteousness, a princess shall rule in judgment, and a man shall be as a hiding place from the wind, covert from the tempest, as rivers of water in a dry place, as the shadow of a great rock in a weary land. And the eyes of them that see shall not be dim, and the ears of them that hear shall hearken or listen with the intent to obey. The heart also of the rash shall understand knowledge. You know, those that are rash jumping into stuff. And the tongues of the stammerers shall be ready to speak plainly. Why? Because they've waited and they've actually got all that they need to be kings and princes. Right? They got, see, so sometimes we think our talent is enough, or what we know. And so we actually are debating, fighting, and challenging people that we know more than, right? But we apply less than. See, we think we don't need them because of what we know, but we need them for what they show. There is no company, no business, no ministry, no team that does not want to benefit from somebody that's going to be an asset. So I'll use me since y'all like, you know, just whipping me. So I'll use me. So I work for a company. I never worked in this field before. Went to school for psychology, didn't like the class, took business, and I pretty much majored in basketball, okay? minored in art and creative writing, right? So I leave school and I end up working with juvenile corrections people, which ultimately that's what I was supposed to be doing. I didn't realize that, right? So I leave that job and I take on a job at a company called North American Van Lines, right? You probably see their trucks riding around. And when I took the job, I never did it before, so I went in and I said, hey, I've never done this before, but I need a job. Tell you what, hire me, pay me whatever you want for a 90-day grace period. If I show you I can do the job in Excel, then give me what I deserve. This is not a made-up story. This is actually happening. And so after the 90 days, I went to the guy and said, it's been 90 days. I said, I know I'm not only doing the job, but I'm excelling. Pay me, right? Now, I ended up doing the job so well, the company that I worked for was a company underneath North American Van Lines. So it was this moving and storage company. Some father gave the son a company, and he was just cussing people out. You could tell he didn't even know how to be a leader, right? And so I excelled to a point where North American's looking over at the other company and like, we need this guy. So they hired me away from the company. One of the few people with my status, I won't get into the specifics of what that status was, hired for their company as a manager. Then they started training me to run a terminal, which is unheard of. So this is good. Something I've never done before. All this sounds good, right? It's just one problem. I had skill. I understood it greatly. But my challenge was the venom that would come out my mouth. And when I mean by venom, not just, I wasn't necessarily cursing nobody out because I stopped cursing. So I'm not talking about that type of venom. I'm talking about, I said everything I saw and didn't care what you thought about it. So instead of operating wisdom, which I didn't know about, I just operated in, is it the truth? So I'm the type of person who would tell you the truth, like it's the truth, walk away like it's the truth, you figure it out. No tact. No wisdom, not understanding that these people are in positions, I shouldn't make them look bad. So I had to, if I was operating in wisdom, they would have still felt they were valuable and still been able to take in my information to enhance their company. Amen. But since they look like all fools to me, I'm like, look at this idiot. You don't know what you're doing. You don't know what you're doing. You don't know what you're doing. So I used to come in. I'm harassing everybody. Because what? The standard of working in this company, you may know this because trucking, was per pound, per man, per hour. So tonnage, you know, you make money based on your tonnage, right? So if we loaded, you know, a certain amount, they make a certain amount of money. So 500 pounds per man per hour was like phenomenal. Unheard of. They made tons of money. That's a $500,000 for them, you know, an hour. My team did 1,500 pounds per manpower, three times over that amount. The reason why is because not only was I a staff member, I unloaded a 48-footer by myself. Like two tiers, you know, they had two tiers. So this was my workout. I was pursuing basketball. This was my workout. So now I know what I'm doing, no one's doing. I'm making y'all money, like money. I went in there and got a raise based on y'all making $500,000 an hour. Y'all paying me 13. Do the math. Do what you got to do. I'm going to do what I got to do. I got a raise that day. So now I'm walking in. I'm getting everybody raises. If you on my team, hey, these guys, I know they just came off the boat, but they working hard. No, for real. Literally, a lot of these people, I wasn't trying to be critical. A lot of them just came. I was on the East Coast. They just came right off the boat, for real. I thought I was just making it. No, they literally came off the boat. So they tried to pay them peanuts. I was like, no. These guys deserve this. So now I'm getting on their nerves because people that normally don't know they're supposed to make money, I'm actually coming in. I would come in the office like that's their representative, but I was supposed to be with management. Management was supposed to be my team. But I'm actually speaking for the people that ain't supposed to know they're supposed to make money. And I'm getting money. And I walked in every day, oh, how I hate my job, how I hate my job. I sing this all day. I look back in hindsight, my blind spot, I remember their faces, they would be getting red. Like we want to punch this guy in the face, beat him up, fire him, but we can't do none of those. I wasn't the dude back then to be messing with. Back then, I mean, I'm not the guy to mess with in Christ now, but I'm saying I was a little edgy. But this is a lot edgy, okay? All right, but this is my point. I was skilled. I made the money. They needed me. Right? Not at the expense of my character. You realize your character show up before your skill? Nobody in their right mind would have fired me. But if nobody can function around me, like, you're going to see this, NFL's coming up, they're about to get rid of some folks. Because it's like, man, we can't, they good, but they, oh my God, we can't deal with this fool. He ain't with the team. I wasn't with the team. I made the team money, but I wasn't with the team. Y'all think I'm talking about me? See, again, I was supposed to sit in the oven for a little longer. I was supposed to stay isolated behind the scenes. I was supposed to navigate through levels, right? I orchestrated levels. And they were all temporary, every single one of them. Every single one of them. Yeah, my wife told a story when she moved out here, she got fired for the first time. That's not my story. I got fired from working upstate New York. They needed me too. Listen, we got this guy here, we ain't got to worry about no riots. But I flowed a certain way and other people didn't flow. They tolerated it to a point where it's like, man, we got to let this guy go. Because if we don't, everybody's going to be doing this. And they needed me. They tried to hire me back. I didn't take the job because I was like, well, I won't be able to do what I want to do. Y'all control me now. See, all these little lessons I'm trying to... See, I'm using my life to talk to you about yours. All right, okay, all right. Stay with me, all right? All right, see, so the Bible says this in Proverbs 25:2. It says, it is the glory of God to conceal a matter and the honor of kings to search it out. It's the glory of God to seal a matter, keep it hidden and covert, behind the scenes, right? Right, but kings, people that have great character, they're going to search it out. They're going to go deep and get buried in that glory, right? Until that glory gets in them and elevates them to kings. People that are not kings will give up on the search. Right? We'll try to jump up. Look, you're supposed to get buried in the glory. We'll try to jump up out the grave of glory. Man, I'm in here too long, man. Can't nobody see me. Can't nobody see me. I need to be seen. I'm used to being seen. I was daddy's girl, mama's boy. I need to be seen. It's all about me, my attention. Can't be around no situation without the attention being on them. Hey, I'm here. Y'all don't know me, but you're going to know me now because I need to be known. And everybody knows that I'm special. As opposed to somebody discovering you. How many of us have allowed ourselves to be discovered? All made up, attracting flies. I was going to explain that. I'm going to let y'all think about that one for a second. You see somebody dressed up with a bunch of flies around them, what you thinking? They don't look like it though, do they? All made up. I don't understand why I keep getting these stinky people. Alright, see, it costs all of us. This is why King searched out the glory. It costs all of us to dig deep enough to allow God to release the treasures within us, his best for last. See, while I'm digging into his glory, I gotta get rid of me. I gotta allow myself to be buried. We're gonna talk about this when we get into the wild love teaching, right? See, the answers are in the glory of God, not in your head. Not in you being seen, not in your networking. It's in the glory of God. You must travel through the glory of God to reach your solution, your best for last. You ain't getting around it. And guess what? You can't bring everything into God's glory. God's an all-consuming fire. So all the things you pick up in compromise, you can't. You know how rocket ships go through different atmospheres? But how it left the earth is not how it ends up on the moon. It sheds some things, don't you? Doesn't it? Because the whole rocket can't go through every level of atmosphere. So God is saying, hey, come unto me, all you that are heavy laden. I'll give you rest for your souls. I'll give you some peace. And then we're like, okay. Whoa, slow down, Tex. You can't bring that in here. Okay, all right. Whoa, you can't bring down here. Oh. This ain't nothing. I mean, I'm just looking at it. I'm not really in a real relationship with it. I just look at it from time to time. You can't bring down here. Okay. Whoa, what's that in your heart? Oh, no, I can't come up in here. You got to get rid of that, too. Oh, no, just from time to time, I'm just a little bothered because it seemed like, you know, they overconfident. They always cracking jokes. You know, it seemed like they, you know, to me, it seemed like they think they better than folk. Oh, no, you can't bring it out of here. You got to be able to love them, too. Oh, so you're not going to receive their wisdom because it wasn't packaged in your personality? Who's to say I like your personality? Who's to say people aren't sitting back going, you need to change? Take that mold out of your eye, and maybe you can come in. Okay, I'm ready now. Whoa. You think that fear coming in here? That insecurity is coming in here? You lying to yourself is coming in here? All that you approving yourself, you think is coming in here. Oh, no, you ain't even ready for the glory. Come back when you're ready. See, this is the thing. We don't want to get buried. We keep holding on to ourselves. Can you begin again? How many situations God bring you in, you got to start over? But you want to make sure people know what you've done. Based on what? Let them discover it. Have you ever done that? You can't begin again ever. When have you started at the beginning, started, built, and grew within something? Ever. I ain't showing up unless I'm the man, or unless people see I have a particular impact. So it's all about you then. It's not about God. Hey, I'm not going to try out for the team again because I could get embarrassed. That's about you. You don't want to bury yourself in humility, do you? Well, I don't want to be accountable because then people can ask me questions, expect things of me. I'll just stay, but I'm a behind the scenes person. No, you're not. You are not wanting to be buried so God can use you person. Right? Yeah, you know, I'm just behind the scenes, you know, just behind. You know, humility looks like glory. Because if I'm deep in humility, all the glory of God is on me. Humility doesn't look like shy. All right, okay, all right. Got a question about that, you can ask me later. Don't be getting all tripping, because that's been your angle. So this is the thing. God created something so awesome. It takes our life, right? Present yourself as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto him, right? Which is your reasonable service, right? Romans 12:1, right? Right? Okay. So it takes our life to see it all. See, scripture says unless you're born again, you can't even see the kingdom of God. You can't enter into God's realm, his way of doing things. John chapter 3. And the explanation of born again was just like you're submerged in water and you're birthed into the earth realm, you got to be submerged in the spirit to be birthed into the kingdom realm. But how many of us are submerged in the spirit? We scared of speaking in tongues in the kingdom. Because you got to let go to do that, right? You ain't going to do that in your head. But then what we do is we are justified. Like I know some people in certain religions, that that's of the devil. Did you research that? Or then that's your out to yield. See, we only want to participate in what we can control. So we don't want God's best. Because if we're controlling it, it can't be God's best. I said if we're controlling it. I said that, right? You heard me say we, right? It can't be God's best because we got our hands on it. We ain't the best. God is. If we're doing anything great, the competency is not of ourselves. It's God through us doing it. You realize that? Apart from him, I can do nothing, right? You see that? So it's going to take all of us. See, it's so interesting. The scripture says you can't see the glory of God. You know, the Bible says no man has seen the Father and lived, right? But I noticed it said no man, but it didn't say no priest or king or anointed person. It says no man has seen the Father and lived. But if I've submerged myself in Christ, I can see the Father because now I'm gone. I'm buried in Christ. See, we call ourselves Christians. Christian says means we live in Christ. Do we live in Christ? Right? Think about the statement. I live inside of Christ. Do we live in Christ? Or do we visit Christ and then we come back out into the world and then we go back to Christ and we come back out in the world. We go into the flesh and we come back in the world. We go into anger. We come back in the world. We go into offense. We go into pornography. We come back. Are we living in Christ? Right? See, so if I'm the anointed one, I probably can see God, but that old less than self can't see him, right? See, this is the thing. God, what God has for us, abundance is his cover. And anybody in the flesh is overwhelmed with abundance. It's just too much because you can't control it. That's the whole thing. Our cup runneth over. You're not supposed to control what God has for you. You're supposed to get submerged by it, overtaken by it. You're supposed to drown in it. It's supposed to flood you and overtake you. Right? Now think about what I just said. It's supposed to overtake you. How much in our life have we allowed to overtake us, to bury us? How much in our life has we have allowed to bury us. We're struggling with the relationships we're in. Because a lot of us are holding back in a relationship. Right? You know what I'm talking about? Because you've been hurt before, right? And ain't nobody gonna hurt you no more, right? You know that was the adversary's trick, right? Get you hurt and have you plan off of the hurt so you won't go all in the next relationship. Right? So you sit around in your own protective custody alone. Was that insensitive? All right. Sorry if it was insensitive, but it's true. Right? So this is the thing. What God has for us is abundance is his cover. His best is abundance of his cover. It's hidden in greatness. Greatness, right? You have this treasure hidden in the earthen vessel. So, but we know this. The Bible says what's in the dark shall come to light. Luke 12, 2 through 3. So if something is hidden, the goal is for it to be manifested. So God's best for last may be hidden until his appointed time, but the goal is for it to come to light, right? But he needs us to just be still and know that he's God, right? Be still and know that he's God, right? So a lot of times people that are conquerors or victors or operating God's best for greatness, they're covert covenant conquerors. So they're in covert, they're in covenant with God, they trust the covenant, and he resurrects them to conquer. They're living covert, right? They stay in covenant, we stay in covenant through obedience, right? And God resurrects them to conquer. They live in covert, so in the unseen, waiting for God to resurrect them from there, right? Stay in covenant. Right? I'm going to be obedient to everything God says in his word. Let that build my character. So my default is obedience. So when God gives me the best, my default is what? Obedience. Now think about this. Just take a second. Just be honest with yourself. If God gives you his best right now, is your default obedience? You know, nobody has to raise their hands. I just want you to think it through. See, that's the thing. It's like we're okay with compromise. We tell ourselves, hey, you know, I'm just getting there, this, that, and the other. Okay, God's best is saying the same thing. Behind the scenes, his best is saying, oh, I'm getting there. I'm coming. Yeah, hey, your best is saying this. God's still working on me. God's not finished with me. Hey, well, you know, your best is saying, hey, nobody's perfect. See, because the same measure you meet will be measured back to you. So after that moat gets out of your eyes, start talking about the measurements. You know, Matthew 7, right? We talked about that next door too, right? All right, so I love it because Jesus' meekness got him under the radar. Now meekness, now as we notice in Matthew 3, Sermon on the Mount, we know that humility and meekness are the keys to conquering the earth, heaven and earth, right? Those are the two key things. Now, humility is empty of self. Think about it. So I'm totally filled up with him. I'm empty of self. That's what true humility is. That's why I said it looks like God's glory. Now, meekness is not self-seeking. So that means once I get empty of self, I don't go back and try to feed self into the vessel that's now in a position to be filled up with the fullness of God, right? So Jesus was empty of self. I mean, he came in at one with God, right? But he was meek. He wasn't self-seeking. Hey, I healed you. Don't tell nobody. Just go see the priest. Like he wasn't really trying to gain a platform. Everything that came out of his mouth, I'm not here to do my will, but the will of the Father. I'm not here to do my new will of the Father. You see me, you see the Father. Everything was focused on the Father. You see what I'm saying? He wasn't self-seeking. That kept him under the radar for. I mean, how are you, the Messiah? And for 30 years, very few people, if any, Because the people around him didn't realize what he was doing. You know, Mary's like, we'll ponder that in our heart, but what is he talking about? 30 years, because you go 30 years, you're the Messiah, and don't nobody see a miracle. You came down for an assignment, and you got power. People talking about you. Why are you becoming a carpenter? Man, I, people are like, based on their limited sight, what are you fixing? He probably was doing crown molding before it was even was heard of. And I guarantee these people pick up, man, why are you rounding that off? That's not how we do it. Squares. Do you know what a square is, Jesus? Square. Oh, man, this guy don't know what he's doing. He always doing, what is that? Right? I can see him being misunderstood because he sees stuff nobody sees. But he had to what? Stay covert until the time he was supposed to be revealed. But he was obedient in his covert for the entire 30 years. We know this because it says he was touched on all points like us, but sinned not. So he's ripe for greatness. Are we? You see the difference? All right, okay, you see that. So his meekness got him under the radar. See, God is hiding some of us covertly for a reason. Right? Some of us are his remnant. Let's look at 1 Peter. Got a few minutes here. 1 Peter I don't know why I said that. We don't have enough time for what we all need. Is it 1 Peter? Yes, 1 Peter 2:19-20. Right? 1 Peter 2:19-20. So we're on the covert, right? And I'm going to read verse 18 just for keep it somewhat in context. So servants, be subject to your masters with all fear, all reverence. It says, not only to the good and gentle, but also the forward. So it's saying my responsibility and obedience is to be subject to whoever is leading me, regardless of the good, bad, indifferent, tripping, or whatever. My job is to be obedient. Now it goes on to explain, verse 19. It says, for this being obedient, is thankworthy. But this is thankworthy, if a man for conscience towards God, so my whole time is I'm focusing on who? God, right? Conscience toward God, endure grief, suffering wrongfully. See, we think we get a pass because it's unfair. It says, look, so it's saying stay buried, stay being misunderstood, take it patiently, right? It says, for what glory is it when you be buffeted for your faults, you take it patiently. But if you're wrong, you should take it patiently. Some people don't take that patiently, right? It says, but if when you do well and suffer for it, you take it patiently, this is acceptable with God. Because God knows whatever unfair thing comes at you is going to kill that flesh. Yeah, that's good. He said, just take it. Stay buried. No, they don't understand who I am. Good. They don't need to understand who you are. You've been the problem the whole time anyway. Right? Right? So we're sitting back behind the scenes, and if we do it right, we'll sit back in the voice of God. We'll submerge ourselves in God. And our response will be in the wisdom of God, not in the knowledge of man. Right? See, the scripture tells us in Matthew chapter 10, he gives us the baseline. He says, forgive us our debts. Right? As we forgive our debtors. So we're saying debts. So a lot of times when we're not being sons of God, sons and daughters of God, we're falling short of our design and the authority and the character we're supposed to operate in. We create a debt. And so we're asking God, forgive us our debts for not being what you purposed and designed us to be, for not walking the power and the glory you have. Look, as we forgive, are debtors. These people that are our tutors and governors and our trainers and our leaders, they were really supposed to be walking in God's design and affording us the wisdom for us to get to the next level. But some of them have missed it, right? And they've gotten into compromise. They haven't operated in obedience. So they're talking to us like they're crazy. Half of the time, they're so blind, they don't know what they're doing. But it says, hey, God, half the time, I've been blind, not know what I've been doing. I've missed it. I've mishandled people. You ain't snapping on nobody? This week? You know what I'm saying? Or you wasn't feeling some kind of way, Mrs. Morris said, no, I ain't snapping on nobody this week. All right? You know what I'm saying? What I'm saying is like, you haven't misunderstood somebody? Got offended? Stopped speaking? Around people, but suppressing, not, you didn't even ask them a question. They affected you. You didn't even tell them it affected you, but you're operating in the effect. But you want God to forgive that, right? So look, forgive our debts, not operating in the character which you want us to operate in, not operating in the clarity and design you want us to get, as we forgive our debtors. You see that? Right? So the scripture says, okay, John 1. Let's go to John 1. Obviously, we're not going to get to all this today, so, but trying to offer what God wants us to do, God's saying, hey, I know the thoughts I have towards you to bring your expected end for the best, and you think that I'm cheating you when you don't realize you're cheating me. So, it's John chapter 1. We're going to focus on verse 12, but let's read verse 11. Well, verse 9. It says, that was the true life. We're talking about Christ. Well, that was the true life, which light of every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him or was intimate with him not, right? And he came into his own, right? And his own what? Received him not, right? It's happening to this day. Look at verse 12. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become sons of God, even to them that believed on his name. See, to them he gave power to be sons, to manifest into his best. But we had to receive him. See, remember, Christ showed up and he started talking and people were like, what are you talking about? Pray for my enemies. No, love my enemies. Pray for them that despitefully use me, that treat me wrong. My response to people treat me wrong is to pray for them. My response to people trying to sabotage my life is to love them. You done lost your mind. So I'm not receiving when I do that. I can't comprehend, and what I don't comprehend, I don't take in. Because that's not my truth. Your truth ain't gonna get you his greatness. His truth will. But I have to receive it. So we have all these different principles that God is communicating, because Christ is communicating through his word. In the beginning was the word. Word was with God, and the same was God, right? The word became flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld him, the only begotten of the Father. That's verse 14. After verse 11 and 12, right? So he's the word. So when we receive the word, absorb the word, and are obedient to the word, we receive him. And we actually are taking in the power to become sons of God. Now we can be walking his best, because now that you abide me, my words abide in you, you can ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. But if I'm not taking in the word, I don't receive the word. If I'm in my head rationalizing why it's not valuable, why it's not important, why I don't think it take all that, I'm not absorbing it. Because I've established it doesn't harmonize with what my will or what I think. So my will and my think is going to allow me to become something, but not a son and daughter of God. I got to receive everything. his will, right? We talked about that in Healing and Wholeness, right, on Bible Study Fellowship. Once I receive his, see, we all are struggling sometimes as we grow. We have a will, and we don't want to die to that will. Everybody struggles to, okay, well, if I let go, well, what's going to happen? You know, I just can't let go. Suppose this ain't true. But you're not saying that about the relationship that you get caught up in. You're not saying that about the relationships you're around. You're not saying this about jobs and things like that. When it comes to the most important thing for your life, the kingdom, why are you questioning it? With limited understanding, at least try it. Apply it. Not by faith. I ain't talking about by fear. Because if you shall not doubt in your heart, is what the scripture says. Right? So you understand what I'm saying? Then gave you power to become sons of God. Now you can experience God's best. His best has been earmarked, designed, treasure hidden, all spiritual blessings in heavenly places, Ephesians 1:3, for his sons and daughters of God. Why would God pour out his best when you're giving him less than? It takes all of you. Is that too much to ask for somebody that's going to give you everything? Because you don't just want something. Or something. You don't even just want something. You want everything. Even though you acting like you don't. Okay, you don't want everything? Why are you working so hard then? Why are you working at all? Why don't you just be like these people around the corner here just living out there in the tent? What are you saving for then? The people that save it. I know some of y'all probably ain't got that revelation yet. You might want to say, right? Why? Why are we navigating? Why? How do you get attracted to gambling, hustling, stocks, bonds? Some of y'all make like 10 times, 7 times, 6 times, 3 times as much as we do. We good because we got what we need. We're content. We're not satisfied because we like stuff too, like everybody else. We just get it when we can. Like when we got the money, that means, not when we got the credit. But I'm saying that, I'm not saying that to put nobody down. What I'm saying is, do we embrace reality? We want everything. Are we giving everything? God is not mocked. Whatsoever you sow, that you shall reap. I don't know why we're frustrated. We're getting what we give. Does that sound, because I wasn't trying to be sarcastic or nothing. I'm just saying, like, and I know, I am very aware that I repeat things, just for the record. But I'm no different than your teachers in school. Actually, I am different. I don't have you every day, 5 days a week, for 8 hours. Lord knows I wish I had that opportunity. Seriously. No, I'm just saying, because it'll take better. But they repeat stuff. Oh, after you heard the number one, you never use number one again, huh? And when, every time you hear number one, why you keep saying one? I know that already. That's what we're doing? Especially if it got extra zeros behind it, right? We're using one all the time, right? Do you understand what I'm saying? Like, so I repeat things for that. Like, because I know we need, this has to be our default. We need to realize it. We need to get it, and you're not going to get it because you heard it one time. Go back and read that book that's your favorite book. Matter of fact, just read one chapter this week of your favorite book that you read. And he's like, oh, you're always talking about. Read just the first chapter. That's it this week. Guarantee you're going to see stuff like, man, how come I didn't read this before? Do you understand? This is why we're doing this. Okay, so I know we got to get out of here. So the scripture says all creation is waiting for the manifestation of the sons of God. The best is not about us. The best is about God's creation and his kingdom. When God manifests his best through us, then his kingdom gets what the supply that they need. Each one of us are a resource for God's kingdom. But God benefits when we've decreased and he can use our full vessel to pour out his full best. So God's best for last is for him as much as it is for us. When we talk about the wild love teaching, you're going to see how it's all intertwined. Like, he needs us just as much as we need him in this earth realm. He set it up that way. Right? And if we don't recognize this, we're going to cheat ourselves. I just think about the value of covert and how people end up becoming God's best and impact our lives. Look at David. Just tending sheep behind the scenes. Everybody else getting props, going through the military academy, you know, fighting in the wars, being trained to be kings, his brothers and them. And then when it's time to appoint a king, they get called up, first invite, for to see if they're the ones that's going to be anointed. He ain't even get called. He ain't in the academy. He ain't fighting with the armies. He gets no props to go. Now, that's a soldier right there. His brothers is getting all that. He is a soldier. He's a warrior, and he knows it. He takes out a bear and a lion, but nobody's there. But if he was taking out soldiers, it'd be like, that dude right there, he got potential. He's going to be next king, man. You think they called his brothers just to be calling them? They called them because they were trained for this. He's behind the scenes. Then gets anointed. See, that's the thing. Y'all get endorsed and like, you're like, where my platform? Where I go? He went back and tended sheep. I'm anointed, but God's going to resurrect me to the throne. And then when it was time for the throne, he didn't take it on compromise. Tell you what. You can run us, but you're going to have to do it this way. Oh, no. If you're saying I can't be king and be obedient to God, y'all can go ahead with your bad self. I don't want the kingdom, even though I've been waiting all this time after I was anointed. I roll with Judah since they're the only ones that want to do it God's way. For 7 years, and he's supposed to be the king. Then finally he gets the whole kingdom. He rolling in the kingdom. His son comes against him. Do you understand? Like, David is an example of covert behind the scenes and letting God resurrect him. Jesus, behind the scenes, let God resurrect him. Look at the greatness from being behind the scenes. John was in the desert. How come he was hanging out in the populous cities on a street corner? They came to him. How do you know somebody come at you in the desert to hear what you got to say? See, we don't want to be in a desert. And sometimes we look for a relationship. We go hang out in with a crowd. So you going to marry all them people? All you doing is making her hard. I'm going to go over there because, you know, there's a lot of available folk. One pastor said that recently. I got a lot of women in my church. Sorry about that. Well, I didn't say his name. Somebody just told me that when they met the person. Basically, so why is that attractive? And I'm not saying that because I'm a pastor. When I was in college, they would run over to the girls' dorm. Like, y'all go over to the girls' dorm. I wait a couple weeks. I walk over there by myself. Like, I'm not trying to run to a crowd. You're just going to be overwhelmed. I only needed the one. I didn't need all y'all. You understand what I'm saying? Like, what are we doing? I need the purpose. I don't need to be doing what everybody's doing. Man, you can make money doing this. You can make money. I'm sure I can, but that's not what God told me to do. Hey, tell you what, man, I'll hook you up. And this is true stories. People told me, man, I'm making a lot of money. You've been a blessing to me. Let me hook you up with doing this. I said, man, it looked like that's a very prosperous thing, but that's not what God told me to do. This was even before I was a pastor, as a minister. Because I don't want to do nothing if God didn't tell me to do it. So I'll just stay behind the scenes. People were coming up to me while I was a minister. So when you start your church? Right now, I'm serving this ministry. I'm not focused on the church. I'm going to be faithful what God told me to do. And it's not going to help me to be, I can't wait till I get my own church. I can't wait till I get my own church. I can use all that energy to be faithful in what I'm doing. This is not interview anybody that comes to this church. We have a lot of people come visit, right, that I've known for ages. Just interview them. Don't take my word for it. I mean, pull them to the side. You can't. How was he? Was he always talking about pastoring? Well, you were there. I mean, I had people like, well, I don't understand. I think you should have your own church. That's nice that you think I should. One person said, well, based on how I see you roll, you should have this by now. I said, well, the interesting thing is God is not assessing me based on your assessment. There's things inside me he don't think I'm ready yet. I'll just trust God. So I'm not just telling you this at 61, be 62 in August. I've been living this. I never wanted to be out of here. Even when I play college basketball, don't put me on that court unless I know the game. So I just endured whatever they threw at me. I said, but once I get out there, y'all ain't gonna be able to get me off. Everything that God has done in my life has not been temporary because I just wait on him. Well, that's not a true statement. I believe it's true, but it's not. Because I know there's some things I got ahead of God on. Those were temporary. Everything I waited on God for has not been temporary. That's probably more of an accurate statement. Don't want to say none. I know I ain't been perfectly waiting on God, you know, because I did some zealous things. And I remember, you know, as I was saying, the Holy Spirit said, well, you remember you did this with the basketball program. Remember you left this and went to this team when I told you to stay. Remember you went to try to play for this team and I told you to stay on this team. That happened a lot, you know, right? So I'm just saying there's something that happens in covert. And you know, last week we had talked about, I'm in here, but last week we had talked about, I believe it was last week, remember we talked about the oak tree, the difference between the oak tree and the tulip? Right, and we talked about that patience. So I just want to give you this scripture, Proverbs 12:12. All right? And then we'll get out of here, okay? I know you're so in a rush to get out of here. That's not fair. That's not nice. You might not be in a rush. Proverbs 12:12. It says, the wicked desires a net of evil men. It says, but the root of the righteous yieldeth fruit. The root of the righteous. Remember when we were talking about that tree, the root of the righteous are patient enough until the fruit manifests. See, these unique best for last candidates you won't find in a crowd. You won't find best for last candidates in a crowd. They're covertly hidden away. They're God's remnant. You won't find God's remnant in a crowd. Because the scripture says, broad is the way that leads to destruction, but narrow is the way that leads to life and peace. I know I'm saying the scripture not exactly right, but Matthew 7:13. Why? And it says, not many be that go thereby. It says, not many people are traveling the narrow way to get God's best, right? Isaiah 37:31 says, and the remnant that is escaped of the house of Judah shall again take root downward and bear fruit upward. Look, the remnant that is escaped of the house of Judah, those that are not been taken out, it says, shall again take root downward, right? Buried, hidden, not be seen, and bear fruit upward. When we talked about that oak tree's roots, Isaiah 37:31. There's those deep roots again, right? The New Living Translation says this, and you who are left in Judah, who have escaped the ravages of the siege, will put roots down in your own soil and grow up and flourish. For a remnant of my people will spread out from Jerusalem and a group of survivors from Mount Zion. The passionate commitment of the Lord of heaven's armies will make this happen. right? But the remnant are those that actually stay in covert and allow themselves to be grown and nurtured, character to be built, and wait for God to resurrect them from there, right? And I know people, you know, we get weird and well doing and we go, but it's taking too long. It's a relative statement. We're making it take long by our compromise. It has this established time already, but we're extending our time. You know, when we go compromise, because now when you come back in place, the stuff that you took in got to be purged out of you too. You see what I'm saying? So now you just created a greater delay. Right? Just something to think about. Stand on our feet. That's all for today. Somewhat stretching, sobering, challenging, but God wants us to get his best. Do you want God's best? Yes. Well, let me hear somebody say, I want God's best. All right. Are you going to give God your best? All right. Well, let me hear somebody say, I'm going to give God my best. Right, so, and we talked about confessions earlier. I don't think that's a bad confession. I want God's best, but I'm going to give him my best. Did that offend anybody? Did that come across like cultish or anything? You know, I mean, you know, because we confess a lot of different things. We were talking about that with AA earlier. I know I said this publicly, but it's true. We just talked about it. How sometimes you're confessing things that don't line up with who God is, right? And when you go through these programs, they're not saying, I'm going to get you to confess something. It's not who God is. People cannot harmonize you to what they don't know about, right? So we're confessing things that line up with what God wants for us, okay? Does that make sense? So how about one more time? I'm going to give God my best. And I desire his best. All right, one more time. I'm going to give God my best. And I desire his best. Now, respectfully, some people probably didn't communicate that because they don't believe they could do it. Right? In some cases, or some people just don't like when somebody asks them to confess something because they, you know, they want to be in control. You know, I recognize all these things, but when you're okay with harmonizing with what God's people are doing, that breaks your will. And Scripture says, except the corner we fall to the ground and die, get buried. That seed goes in the ground and gets buried and it's broken. And it releases the greatness on the inside. But while it's going through that process, you can't see it. John chapter 12, 24. So I'm not making this up. Except the corner we fall to the ground and die, it can't bring forth fruit. It can't bring forth God's best. It has to be buried and broken to release the best, the treasure hidden in it. So some things are stretching our will so it can break us. Some things are trying to empty us and we'll be buried, right? You know, when we take on the world, it kind of attracts us to the world. When we empty ourselves in the world, we actually start to get buried more and submerged more in God, okay? That's why I like to explain stuff, because sometimes I was the guy, so the reason why I can explain it, because I was like, man, I'm not saying that. I didn't even think about what the person was saying. I'm not saying it because they're saying it, but sometimes I was like, man, I don't want to say that, I'm not going to do it. But I said I do before I ever knew I was going to commit to her. It's been 31 years now. I had to commit first. Now, because I committed, what? Now I've already committed. So whatever came at us, listen, I'm committed. I'm in it. So I've committed. So I can't just go anywhere. I came to the altar and accepted Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior. I committed. I didn't know if I was going to live the life out. And I went through a process. But the whole thing I played off of what? I committed. I committed to the kingdom. I can't do that no more. I can't do that. I would tell my friends, I don't drink, I don't smoke. I can't do that. I've committed to Christ. Before I even knew if I was going to be able to stop drinking and smoking, I committed first. We're waiting for favorable conditions to commit. If you keep doing that, you'll never commit. And you'll never experience his best. You wait for somebody to prove to you that it's going to be worth it. But then it wouldn't be faith, would it? But you didn't say that to the relationship that you compromised with. They ain't had to prove nothing to you. How about the one-night stands? You got like two people who's like, I never had a one-night stand. I wasn't talking to you, okay? All right? And I can kind of really let you know, those that don't think they had a one-night stand, I can show you how you have. But I'll let you talk to... I'll let you talk to me later. I won't get you right now. No, they were talking about they didn't physically have a one-night stand with somebody out at a club, apartment, or what have you. But they've had a one-night stand with the adversary and all types of people privately. All right, so anyway, Father God, we lift you up, magnify, exalt you. Just thank and praise you for your wisdom and insight. How you always giving us what we need, Jesus. Amen. All right, let's. All right. It's just what you see. That's all. It's just what you see. That's all. I love y'all. I understand. I understand what y'all meant. Seriously, I respect that. It's cool. So let's pray. Anybody need prayer? This all starts with salvation. If you haven't accepted Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior. If you're online or in the house, the Bible says you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. And we talked about this week, wholeness, that's healed on the inside and outside. The scripture says if you've backslidden, or it says if you confess your sin, God is faithful to forgive you of the sin and cleanse you of the righteousness, 1 John 1:9. And it's hard to live this life without the ambassador that Jesus left, the comforter, and that's the Holy Spirit. So we want to pray for you to experience the infilling, not just the indwelling that you receive when you accept Jesus. Holy Spirit's indwelling in you, but the infilling. And that's the scripture says you shall receive power. After that, the Holy Spirit will come upon you and you'll be a witness to me in Judea, Samaria, to uttermost parts of the world. And that's to Charlotte, to North Carolina, and the uttermost parts of the world. All right, so we want to pray for baptism of the Holy Spirit. And if the Lord is leading you to be a member at Ayers Christian Center Church, the scripture says, they that be planted in the house shall flourish in the courts. So even if it's not Ayers, find a place. We talked about this. We was talking about churches in class. Just find a place that's not just is Bible teaching, love God, but that you can flourish. You're getting the nutrients that's going to help you to grow. It's going to challenge you with the truth. It's going to free you from bondage. Not just going to soothe you, but help you to get buried, broken, so you can flourish, right? So that's why, but you want to find a place, you want to get planted in the house so you can flourish in the courts or the endeavors of your life, Psalm 92:13. So I want to pray for salvation, rededication, baptism of the Holy Spirit, and church membership, and if anything else anybody need prayer for, right? Bible says, cast your cares. So we try to bring our concerns, our cares, our weights to the altar, get in agreement, because two or more gather in his name, there he is in the midst. We touch and agree, and we have the petitions that we desire of him. All right, I know I explain a lot, but we want us to attach our faith to it. All right, prayer for anything. Mr. Bobbitt.
Yes, traveling mercies. So we'll be going.
What does that mean? Traveling mercies. What's that?
Well, just.
I'm playing. I'm playing. My mind. I'm on this roll. I was just like, I know what you mean.
Yeah, so we're going to see Sean. You know, Sean's getting ready to be deployed next month. So we're going to spend some time with him. Yes, pray for him, and then also pray for the boys and the loss of their father.
Okay.
Passed away this week. So.
Gotcha.
Comfort.
I'm just happy for that. Stand in agreement. I just want to pray for Jamie. She had a dentist visit that wasn't as favorable as we would like. And so I'm just believing that God will do some things that she won't need what they said she needs. So,
Oh, and then one more thing. Just a lot of moving pieces right now. So just prayer for peace and a transition, and just that I can hear God and make the right moves.
Gotcha.
Just prayer for balance.
All right. I got you.
I have a quick question. Should I be asking for prayer for being a backslider?
You would be able to answer that question. I can't.
Well, I haven't been able to, so.
All right, well, we'll pray for that.
Okay.
Because the fact that you asked the question means it's.
Okay. And a financial breakthrough.
Gotcha.
Just prayer for Stella, for her health.
Oh, okay. I got you. All right. All right. Is that it?
Prayer for wisdom to help our adult children in their parenting without overstepping our boundaries.
Both of you. What'd you say?
Wisdom to help us with our adult children as they're parenting our grandchildren so we don't overstep our boundaries.
Okay. Got you.
So,
let's go down here.
No, I asked them to come up. They're just coming up because I made the request. Oh, the Lord just had me have them come up. So, yeah.
Just prayer for Stephanie as she's battling. So she's in Texas for a while now, but she's battling through a lot of the transitions. Similarly, like everything you was talking about with your old role. So she's battling through that. So just peace through that and just trust in that God already knows. And so just move.
I got you. Cool.
So I have a prayer request. Do you have a prayer request? Oh. So I have a prayer request for all of us. As you were teaching, this came to me. And I think it's a good prayer for all of us. God is saying that he wants to perform circumcision on all of us, but he needs us to stand still and allow the cutting. He says, I'm cutting away your pride. I'm cutting away your selfishness, your unrighteousness. I'm cutting away you living in fear. I'm cutting away low self-esteem. I'm cutting away unforgiveness. I'm cutting away your will. I'm cutting away your disobedience. And I'm cutting away the lust and stubbornness. Mm. And so we need prayer because here's the thing. When you think about circumcision and he's saying stand still, can you imagine that hurts? And all the things that I listed here, it hurts. And so the Holy Spirit, I'm believing that the Holy Spirit will give us local anesthesia. To perform what he needs to perform. But we gotta be still. Cause if you're not, it can cut the wrong way. You know what I'm saying? You just gotta be still. And this is a season where I believe God is calling us to be still. Like, and know that he's God. Like, be still and know that he's God. And that he wants you to have the best. His best, not even what you think is your best. God has a best better than your best. And so we have to allow the cutting, though. That's the only way it's going to get. Because think about, why would he reward us with all the things I just said? Why would he do that? That wouldn't even be a loving God. That would be somebody setting us up for failure. Because the very blessings that he wants to bless us, we wouldn't be able to hold on to. We're forfeited. Matter of fact, we may not even see it as a blessing. Do you understand what I'm saying? So that's my prayer, Pastor.
All right, that's cool. You mind if I pray for you? Yeah.
Yeah. Running is another one.
I got you covered.
He's cutting away you running. What'd you say? Flight risk?
Flight risk.
Yeah, because we run. We run quick, too. Because it's uncomfortable. It is uncomfortable. So I just wanted to put that out there because we need help. And God is trying to get us his best.
and he's saving it for last. For last. We're the last part. We're living, we're supposed to be living in what? The manifestation. That's the vision that God gave us. But he can't send the manifest, his manifested presence, peace, power, all the things that comes with it, if we are we're spoiled brats. So that's all. I think it's a good prayer for all of us, including myself.
Amen.
So we all, including Pastor.
Amen.
Matter of fact, we need to have somebody else pray. No, I'm just teasing. No, we all need, we do. We need this. We need this. He's trying to perform circumcision. And we got to be still. Yeah, so we can cut away those things. Amen. That's it.
All right. Well, Father God, we lift you up, magnify, exalt you. We just thank and praise you for smooth transitions. We thank and praise you for just the wisdom to know how to be still, to know how to be buried, know how to shift in transitions. We thank and praise you. We lift up comfort over the Walker boys. It's Walkers, right? That's the, okay, good. As you know, they, you know, just go through a grieving process, but also a healing process, a strengthening process, and celebrate the life passed by the life that they live forward. We thank and praise you for, you know, as the Bible's travel, surrounded by the name of Jesus, kept by the blood of Jesus, kept by you. Thank you for a purpose trip, vision trip. We thank you for a time to be locked in. And we thank you for the suddenly, that they recognize the suddenly and move with the suddenly and flow with the suddenly. Lord, we, again, as Rashawn is being deployed, Lord, we believe he's covered by the blood of Jesus, kept by you. Especially with a lot of things happening, we believe, Lord, that you'll navigate him to and fro the things that's going on in this particular country. In the name of Jesus, we believe you'll take care of his family while he's away and as he returns. We also believe as they grow as grandparents, Lord, that you'll give them wisdom, you know, when to apply, when to direct, when to challenge, and when to let things evolve in Jesus' name. Lift up Jamie. We thank you for top of the heads and souls of feet, organ cells, limited tissues, functions, and which you designed to function. We thank you for a creative miracle in her mouth in Jesus' name. But we also ask, we thank you for the wisdom forward, wisdom forward, diet forward. And we thank you for supernatural balance for this young man and just the supernatural anchor, a supernatural anchor to be anchored, and whatever winds come to and fro, he'd be unmovable in his anchor towards you. I'm gonna do her last. Let me do. All right, so lift up CJ, Lord, and we just thank you. Thank and praise you for just a thirst for you, a thirst to spend time with you, a thirst to fellowship with you, but also strength of shift. We know that there is so much you have set up for him on the other side of his obedience, and we thank and praise you for him not to be able to sit still without doing what you told him to do, regardless of the circumstance, regardless of the pressure, regardless of the uncertainty. We'll believe, we thank and praise you for the ability to recognize, act on, and live out obedience forward in Jesus' name. And we lift up this wonderful family. We thank you for wholeness and healing. But in particular for Janae, we thank you for the ability to walk in supernatural forgiveness. No bitterness or resentment to be able to be placed or to stay within her heart and in her being to try to create a foothold or incubator for the adversary to have access to her. There's gifts this greatness, this gifting and calling, and we believe not just this week, but in particular this week through dreams, signs, and wonders, you'll start to illuminate your steps for her, your direction for her, and your purpose for her in the midst of all the noise, in the midst of all the bribes and the options. You'll see clearly to what you plan for her life. And Lord, she'll be walking in a supernatural level of confidence to stand for who she is, what she's purposed to do and purposed to be. And we thank and praise you for her ability to influence everyone around her, draw people into the light and out of darkness. So we just thank and praise you for that in the name of Jesus. So we ask for your daughter for a favor, supernatural favor and blessing, financial breakthrough, the ability to recognize, operate, apply, and be obedient to the requisite wisdom and the requisite obedience that positions her for what you purpose and plan for her life. So we thank and praise you as we go through this confession. We believe, Lord, as she confesses in her mouth, rededication to her heart, Lord, you meet her at that place, Lord. And come into her heart, move, enlighten, and create a shift in thirst and appetite for time with you, time to fellowship with you, and that time to be quenched. So I'm going to ask you, Sister Joyce, if you could just lift your hands up just as another level of surrender and repeat after me. Lord Jesus, I thank you that you love me and you see my heart. And right now I'm offering any level of sin in my life. And I renounce any level of sin, any level of disobedience. I confess I've missed it, but I'm returning to you. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Live as my Lord and Savior. Holy Spirit, fill me up. Guide me. Lead me into the life designed for me. In Jesus' name, amen. Glory to God. All right, if you guys can thank the Lord for those prayers. Oh, hold on. I apologize. Father God, we lift up Stella and we just thank you for the top of her heads, the soles of her feet, or all ligaments and tissues are functioning in perfection, which is designed to function. We thank you. There's no malfunctions in her body. By your stripes, she is healed. Thank you. The rest she needs, restoration she needs, recreation she needs, so she can walk in the recovery that you want her to operate in. We lift up. I pray for Stephanie already, and then, Lord, we just thank and praise you for all of us, Lord, that we can be still as you purge, as you cut, as you remove all the things that's restricting the flow into what you purpose and plan, and some of the things that's coming in the way of us of building the character to handle what our gifting is going to produce. So we thank and praise you for the ability to allow the cutting. In Jesus' name, amen. Apologize for that, sweetie. All right, we're going to do an offering, and then we'll transition out. Thank you. I just threw all this stuff up. I appreciate it. If you're so led online, you can give at aircc.org. You can give at Cash App or PayPal. Again, we have one offering. It's tithes and offering. We're just honoring the word and the covenant of tithing. The scripture says, shall a man rob God? It says you are cursed with a curse. You say, how are we cursed? Well, in tithes and offering. You know, he says, you know, prove me that I won't pour out a blessing. You won't have room enough to receive. I rebuke the devourer for your sake, and your vine won't cast forth fruit before its time in the season in the field. And I'll tell you, we only do one offering, and the Lord has challenged me. I know we probably went like 10 years where I kind of just blew through tithes and offering, anything about giving, you know, just because of different levels of sensitivity, but it's just such a benefit to our covenant. And so I've, you know, been challenged to kind of weave it in just to remind us, because I know some people are struggling with their obedience even in that area. But once again, we want God's best. But we're allowing the curse, we're allowing the devourer. We're not positioned where our fruit is in the proper timing and the season and resources. And so I don't want to cheat nobody of that. God doesn't want you to be cheated of that. So if you hear from time to time things weaved in, because there's never enough time for people to get to revelation, then this is the other thing. Especially you to have children, you know, like we go through stuff, we got to fight to get a revelation of what God says about tithing and offering. And sometimes we get it, but we got to teach our kids. We got to teach our kids to operate in God's system and not in the world system. You know what I'm saying? So like we were talking about in class, it's kind of hard to teach somebody something that we're not experiencing also. So while we're waiting to get serious about the things of God, our kids are struggling. You know, like, you know, they have jobs. They could be so further. Like I watch, there's some parents around here that teach their kids. The kids get favor, doors break through all the time. Because just from a young age, they're operating in God's system. Right? So don't just think about you. Think about your family. You know, it's some stuff that, you know, we talk to our family about everything. Grandkids around, we're going to talk to them about stuff. So I just wanted to offer that, you know, because sometimes we could be in our own little world and forget that our choices can affect the people that we care about around us. You know, so again, to just live by faith, not grace. Don't take the grace for granted, okay? Just because things ain't happening, it's grace hoping you get the revelation. We don't live by that grace, you know, so. All right, we good? All right, well, Father God, we just thank and praise you for these offerings given online and throughout the week. Lord, we thank you because we're tithing, you're pouring out a blessing. We won't have room enough to receive. You're rebuking the devourer for our sake. Our vine is not casting forth fruit before its time or season in the field. Perfect timing, perfect season, resources, and support. Well, because we give, it's given unto us. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over. Overflow of men given into our bosom. We thank and praise you for your system of giving, your system of tithing, your system in general, and how it keeps us blessed, covered, and protected so we can be a blessing to the body of Christ and the kingdom of God. In Jesus' name, amen. We have a blessing over this offering, the offerings given throughout the week. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, we'll have our announcements and then we'll transition out. Thank you for your ear and attention. And prayerfully, I'll see you on Wednesday for blind spots and blackouts.
All right.
The teaching blind spots and blackouts, not for you to have blind spots.
Praise God. Hello, 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 Ayers family. I was waiting on the energy. Y'all better not be dry today. Come on now, give it up one more time, y'all. Hello, Ayers family. All right, now, let's get some energy in the building. I'm going to run through a couple of quick announcements with you all. Things to come. Women of Ayers, the Ayers Women's Ministry presents the Women's Book Club. We are kicking off the epic event in person on Saturday, April the 27th at 12:30 p.m. outside near the Fellowship Hall. This Women's Book Club will explore our divine design according to biblical principles. We will be starting with the True Woman book series. The Woman's Book Club will fellowship the last Saturday of every month. You can order your True Woman book from your favorite bookstore, including Amazon at christianbookstore.com. We look forward to seeing you there. A couple of quick band updates. The Ayers Women's Ministry still presents the Ladies Workout on Saturday morning at 6 a.m. in the Fellowship Hall. Ladies, let's work it out together. The next Helps meeting is scheduled for Sunday, April the 28th at 9:15 a.m. Helps meeting, April the 28th at 9:15 a.m. in the Fellowship Hall. Let's not forget to stay kingdom-minded, you guys. baptisms. You can contact a member of the admin team or submit your request on ARCC.org by clicking on the Contact Me link. Your tithes and offerings can be made using the tithing envelopes or by visiting ARCC.org and selecting the Giving tab, as well as Cash App and PayPal. You guys know what time it is. It's celebration time. If you have a birthday in the month of April, please stand to your feet. Yes! We have a very special birthday in the building. So blessed to have you here with us. And everybody, we have a very special song from Pastor Mel. Oh, and Pastor Keith, he getting his 30 seconds today. Praise God.
Give us some effects, too. All right. You ready?
Mm-hmm.
Happy birthday to you. Oh, wait, how many? Wait a minute. Who are we singing to? Just Minister Donna?
Minister Donna.
See? Well, we got to sing it to her.
All right, okay, ready?
Okay.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Minister Donna. Happy birthday to you.
Beautiful, beautiful, yes. Happy birthday from the Ayers family. We love you dearly. Thank you, pastors, for blessing us with those vocals. Oh, man. And you guys, let's go ahead and walk through our week. We're going to give it up for the layers that we are afforded here at the church. We start the week off right Monday through Friday with intercessory prayer. Jump on that 5 o'clock line on the Ayers conference line and pray your heart out. Unmute your phones. If you have a prayer request and you need to get it in quickly, email it to prayers@ayerscc.org. But stay on the line in the morning. Don't jump off too fast because we have morning Bible study fellowship at 6 a.m. Yes, we are on until, and that's all that we know. We're on until. It ends at 8, but sometimes we go till it ends. And that could be at whatever time. Morning Bible Study Fellowship, we are right now in 1 Samuel. So you guys jump on the line with us in the mornings. We have our midweek service in the house at 7 p.m. Being here on Wednesday nights, y'all. The blackouts and blind spots has been real. And if you don't know, then you don't know. So come in here so you can learn and know. All right now. Saturday Bible School at 7 a.m. 7 a.m., the early bird gets the worm. Right over there in the fellowship hall, we are still talking about abiding in Christ. And yesterday was so good on the love of Christ, you guys. So if you're needing to get a better understanding of the love of Christ, you should be in abiding in Christ. We still in that book. Sanctified singles. Y'all give it up for these single people out here. We need to be celebrated too. And we meet on the first and third, you guys. We were very blessed by Isaac and Christopher, who did In the Kingdom. We talked about the kingdom on our last meeting. And we have an event coming up on the 20th. So you guys jump on band so you can stay up to date on what's happening with Sanctified Singles. Joint Heirs Marriage Ministry. Let's give it up for the married couples in the building. They meet every second Saturday at 12 p.m. in the fellowship hall. And the fourth Saturday is for couples to have a scheduled date night. I love it, I love it, I love it. Ladies! Okay, I hear y'all. Don't let the fellas beat y'all out. Ladies, y'all on that conference line. We're on there every Thursday at 7 p.m. Sharing our hearts on the line. Fellas! You know. Ladies, we have to do better by next week. Get your vocals up. Guy Talk goes down every Saturday at 10 a.m. on the conference line. The iron is still sharpening iron, you guys. They have some amazing topics. So share both links for the ladies, for the fellas. Share those links and have everybody on those lines so they can share their hearts. Let's give it up for our Air Force Youth and Young Adult Ministries. Ooh, our youth is growing. Our youth is growing. They're coming up right behind us real quick. Ages 12 to 18 meet twice a month on Wednesdays at 7 p.m. and Saturdays at 12 p.m. You guys, let's keep them locked in. And we have to give it up for Kingdom Kindness. Kingdom Kindness is one of our outreach ministries, and they visit the Senior Citizens Bible Study on Woodlawn Haven Rest Home every second and fourth Friday. And as we just discussed this morning, they are coming up on 1 year. Give it up. 1 year of going out and ministering to the hearts of the elderly is so beautiful. Continue to follow and share airs on social media, including Facebook, LinkedIn, Instagram, Twitter, and YouTube. Social media shout out to Janae. Visit the website for more info at www.aircc.org. Thank you all for your time and have a blessed evening.
Glory to God. Praise God, sis. All right, thank you for those announcements, Sister Venetia. I'd have everyone can please stand to your feet so we can prepare to be dismissed. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the message we received on this morning. God's best for last, Heavenly Father. We thank you for covering us, for tutoring us, for mentoring us, Heavenly Father. We just thank you for all that you do for us. We ask that the word rest, rule, and abide inside us. We take that word with us. We allow it to manifest as we live in manifestation based on all the gifts that you have given us. We thank you so much, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.